وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا وحبيبنا ومطاعنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال تعالى بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله لنريه من آياتنا إنه هو السميع البصير. وقال تعالى: والنجم إذا هوى ما ضل صاحبكم وما غوى وما ينطق عن الهوى إن هو إلا وحي يوحى علمه شديد القوى ذو مرة فاستوى وهو بالأفق الأعلى إلى آخر الآيات. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال: قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: إنما أنا رحمة مهداة، وكما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. يا رب صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. ولقد أحسن القائل: بلغ العلا بكماله، كشف الدجى بجماله، حسنت جميع خصاله، صلوا عليه وآله. ولقد أحسن القائل: أولئك أصحاب النبي وحزبه، ولولاهم ما كان في الأرض مسلم، ولولاهم كانت ظلاما بأهلها، ولكنهم فيها بدور وأنجم. اللهم يسر يا رب العالمين. الحمد لله. Honorable elders, ulama kiram, beloved brothers, Allah has blessed us with such a perfect, pure deen. Such a deen that is preserved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. And Allah sent his beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to save humanity from degradation and destruction. Humanity were in darkness, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to this world. Before him, women were ill-treated. Before him, humanity's rights were usurped. Before him, humanity was at its lowest. That even a great Sahabi, Hazrat Salman radiallahu anhu, his name was Mada bin Budikhshan. He was a man from the Persian region. He was a fire worshipper. He was looking for the truth. And he searched and he searched and he searched. And even the Christian priests he went to in Palestine and in Syria, he found them to be astray. And he found those who were good dying without anybody pure to replace them. So it was a dying creed. Humanity was at its lowest. And Allah sent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a means of hidayah to humanity. And Allah took responsibility to preserve his deen, because there's no Nabi to come. وَلَوْ شِئْنَا لَبَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ قَرْيَةٍ نَذِيرًا. Allah says, O my Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if we wanted, like we did in the past, every town had a different Nabi, we could have done this also. But Allah said, no, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how will humanity know how great you are? You are the Nabi, there's no one like you. Everyone's Nabi is you. You are the Nabi to every town. You are the Nabi to every region. You are the Nabi to every nation. You are the Nabi to every color. You are the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to every nationality, country, region, race. Your nubuwa transcends all bounds. And that was proven in his time sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was in Ummu Hani, Fakhita Ummu Hani radiallahu anha's home. He performed his Isha. He went to rest and Jibreel alayhi salam came. Allah's Nabi was taken on a lengthy journey. He was placed on the Buraq. Where was he taken? Allah speaks of this journey in Surah Al-Isra. The name of the chapter is referred to as Isra. Asra, Yusri. Isra means the night journey, the nocturnal journey. Subhanalladhi. When something is amazing, we say Subhanallah. Because what we see is really shocking, amazing. That Allah's glory knows no bounds. Allah is free from every blemish. Our reaction as Muslims is Subhanallah. Whatever we see is that is attractive or amazing. Allah is more beautiful. Allah is more perfect. Allah is that being who is free from every blemish. As a Muslim, our reaction is Subhanallah. So perfect and pure is that being, Subhanalladhi, who took his banda, Asra. Asra abdahu was sufficient. Allah took his banda on that night journey. But emphasis, Asra bi'abdihi. That closeness of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to his Allah is emphasized here. Instead of Asra abdahu, Allah took his banda. That was sufficient. Asra bi'abdihi. More emphatic in the eloquence and the rhetoric of the Quran. Asra bi'abdihi. Allah took his banda at night. Laylan. Not even the entire night. From where? From masjid to masjid. Ummu Hani radiallahu anha's house, Abu Talib's daughter, was right there by the Kaaba. So from the masjid, Allah's Nabi was taken. He was put under the buraq. Buraq started to shudder, started to be ashamed, started to perspire. Jibreel alayhi salam patted the buraq. Buraq, remain still. Ma raqibaka ahadun a'zama minhu. No one greater has ever embarked onto you. In this, Buraq was shocked because the greatest of Allah's creation, Buraq has the opportunity tonight to become the ride, to become the means of conveyance and transport for the greatest of Allah's creation. And Allah's Nabi gets onto Buraq and he's taken on this journey. Layla, a portion of the night. Layla means a bit of the night, not the entire night. From masjid to masjid, min al-masjid al-haram, ila al-masjid al-aqsa. From Masjid al-Haram, Allah's Nabi was taken to the masjid that is the furthest, Aqsa. And Allah describes this masjid, such a place, such a venue. Barakna hawlahu. The entire surroundings are barakat. Around Masjid al-Aqsa is Mubarak lands. And Allah took Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, linuriyahu min ayatina, to show him the glorious signs of Allah. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was taken during the Meccan period. He was oppressed. He was suppressed. He was hurt. He just returned from Taif. How was he treated in Taif? How was he ill-treated there? What he was put through in Taif. His body bled. He still made dua. He forgave those who harmed him. He made dua for their children. Imagine someone ill-treats you, publicly hurts you, disgraces you, and you see his son, and you show him love, and you make dua for his son. Allahu Akbar. The pinnacle of rahmah. The pinnacle of mercy, the pinnacle of kindness and compassion. That Allah give their children hidayah, make their children successful. Who? Those who pelted him. But how hurt was he when he returned? That they didn't accept the deen. That was what hurt him. They didn't get hidayah. But Ajib, a riwayat I learned recently, years later, some men come to meet Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah's Nabi asked them, how is your mother? He said, no, she's fine. She passed away. Allah's Nabi says, your mother, Ruqayqa Thaqafiyya, from Taif. Ruqayqa. When I was there, she called me home. She was old. I gave her dawat. She gave me a special drink she made for me. Sawiq. A specific kind of porridge with barley. She fed me that. And I gave her dawat. She said, how will I accept? Everyone is against us. Allah's Nabi insisted. Nabi sallallahu alayhi insisted to her that do not ascribe partners unto Allah. Do not worship their idolatry. Do not follow them, no matter what they do, no matter what they say. And Allah's Nabi told her children that your mother embraced Islam at my hands. Allah's Nabi went to Taif. This elderly woman got hidayat. So somewhere, invite somebody, make some effort. Allah will give someone hidayat. That person will go home, talk to their children, that person will get hidayat. Effort never gets wasted. He was so hurt, he came back into Makkah. And now he's taken on this journey to give him himmat. There all the Anbiya alayhi wasalam are gathered in Masjid al-Aqsa. Every one of them. And Allah's Nabi meets them. A gathering, an ijtima' of all the Anbiya alayhi wasalam. Imagine what a scene. Imagine what a scenario. Imagine what an occasion. Adhan is rendered. Who's going to be put forth? The expectation was Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, or Hazrat Adam alayhi salam, Hazrat Nuh alayhi salam, senior anbiya alayhi salatu was salam. None of them were made imam. Ana imamul anbiya, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam was made imam in Masjid al-Aqsa. And he led all the anbiya alayhi salatu was salam in the lands of Sham. He is the imam. Then anbiya alayhi salam presented their presentations, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam presented his presentation, and his was explaining Allah's bounty upon him and the ni'mat of Allah in the form of his ummah. Before, every nabi was responsible for the deen. Yeah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's ummah is responsible with him for the deen of Allah ta'ala. What an honor Allah gave him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But interestingly, Allah's nabi is in Makkah. The Meccan people not listening. They chasing him, hurting him, torturing his sahaba. And here he's taken via the buraq. The first leg of the journey is called Isra. This is the first leg of the journey discussed in this chapter. And Allah is mentioning to us, and Allah is taking his Nabi to another land. This land was under Roman territory. It was under the Romans. And their capital was Constantinople, that was the most impregnable city of the world. And this was their spiritual center as well. The Jews and the Christians always fought for it. The Romans were ruling this region, a land under Roman territory. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is taken there. What was the lesson for the world? That all these regions, Allah has given it to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah has given it to him. This was the lesson there. That not only is he a Nabi whose worry is one people, one community, one tribe. Not only he is not one who just has come for a basic achievement to do something, to liberate a people, to bring salvation to a nation. No. The entire humanity in totality is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's meedan. That was the message of that night. That's why Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was taken to Masjid al-Aqsa. That the world has to know who is Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And his role was presented to humanity, that this is your Nabi. And this is the role of his ummah. That this ummah is primary before Allah. This ummah is special before Allah. It started in Makkah Mukarramah. Now, in Makkah, Muslims used to perform salah, because Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam returned. Before Mi'raj, there was salah, but there was tahajjud salah. Some scholars explain two salahs. The complete five prayer, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam returned with that gift from Mi'raj. So Muslims started praying. What was the Qibla? Qibla was Baytul Muqaddas. But their love for Kaaba, in Makkah, they would stand on that side of the Kaaba where they could face Baytul Muqaddas as well. Now they're coming to Medina Munawwara, Hijrah takes place. Few years later, 14th year after Nubuwa, Muharram, Safar, Sahaba started making hijrah. One Sahabi meets Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Hazrat As'ad. He said, O Nabi of Allah, my heart wants to face Kaaba. Allah's Nabi says, no, you follow the rule of Allah. At this time, you're facing Baytul Muqaddas. You in Medina, face Baytul Muqaddas. When Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam arrived in Medina Munawwara, Rabi'ul Awwal, from that time, obviously now, Muslims had to face Baytul Muqaddas. Kaaba is in a different direction. Baytul Muqaddas, different direction. This is Allah's wisdom. Allah is showing us. We don't do as we feel like being. We don't do as we like to do. We do as our Allah wants us to do. This is what the Jews couldn't pass. They wanted Allah to do according to their dictatorship. Allah must do as we want. No. Ye janne ka naam nahi hai, ye manne ka naam hai. Iman is to obey, abide what Allah wants. I have to do. I have to do as Allah wants, how Allah wants. وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Allah's irada. Allah says, oh my banda, you want and I want. You do as I want. Allah is in control. We are slaves. We are slaves of Allah. We are banda. We are banda. Allah reminds us in Quran, هَلْ أَتَى عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ. Insan, you forgot. There was a time No one knew you, Allah is telling us. لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا إِنَّا خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانِ Allah says, I made you. مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ أَمْشَاجِ From mingling of semen, of liquid, that liquid. Elsewhere Allah says, كَلَّا إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاهُمْ مِمَّا يَعْلَمُونَ I made them from that origin that they know, let them think themselves. From such dirt we came, and we want to dictate to Allah. Who are we? We are nothing. Allah is everything. If we obey Allah, then we are successful. If we disobey Allah, انهض إلى الروح واستكمل فضائلها فأنت بالروح لا بالجسم إنسان work on the ruh. Man's body makes him nothing. Animals got body. That ruh has to be connected to Allah. That ruh has to be purified. That ruh has to be cleansed. That the heart has to be connected to Allah. That is salvation. That is success. When we love Allah. When we prioritize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Muslims arrived in Medina Munawwara. 16 months. Baytul Muqaddas. Allah's Nabi wanted to face Kaaba. But Allah's command, Baytul Muqaddas. Until Allah says, Kaaba, we will not face Kaaba. Surah Baqarah. Interesting in the Quran. When studying the Quran, when making tilawah of the Quran, analyze where the chapter was revealed. In Makkah Mukarrama or Medina Munawwara. From surahs, on the one side you'll see the number. This is the number on the right hand side in the sequence of the Quran. What is this chapter? Surah Baqarah number 2. On the other side you'll see another number 88. That means this is from 86, from 87 onward. From 87 onward, these are the surahs revealed in Medina Munawwara. From 1 to 86, these are surahs revealed in Makkah Mukarrama. Not only see where the chapter was revealed, analyze what's the number. Then we know in Makkah Mukarrama, when early Makkah, mid Makkah, latter Makkah. Medina Munawwara, where in Medina? Early Medina, mid Medina, latter Medina Munawwara. Then that will enhance our understanding of the Quran Kareem. So we know when and where about approximately. Baqarah, early Medina. So approximately, that's why Surah Baqarah discusses a lot of dealing with the Jews. As Muslims, we're going to deal with them. Surah Ali Imran discusses the details of the Battle of Uhud. A lot of discussion of Christians. As Muslims, we have to deal with them. We have to interact with them. We have to understand them. We have to invite them. Allah speaks about the goodness in some of them. Allah speaks about the weaknesses and the faults in many of them. Quran is just. Where there's good, Quran highlights that good. Quran is just. Quran doesn't make blanket statements. Quran analyzes the good and the weaknesses and the faults. Quran is the book of life, the book of hidayat. Quran is alive. Surah Anfal, 87. Early Medina. Even before Baqarah. Anfal, probably 88. Baqarah, 87. Check it out, Hafsah. Baqarah, Anfal is on the occasion of Badr. Badr was early Medina. Ali Imran is after Anfal. Ali Imran discusses Uhud. Now in Baqarah, early Medina, 16 months later, Allah tells his Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, قَدْ نَرَى Now interestingly, Surah Baqarah has 286 ayat. 28 is alluding to the number of chapters revealed in Medina Munawwara. 86, the second part of the number, alluding to the number of chapters revealed in Makkah Mukarrama. So Allah says, O my Nabi, certainly we can see, قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ How your gaze is raising to the sky. فِي السَّمَاءِ To the sky. فَلَنُوَلِّيَنَّكَ قِبْلَةً تَرْضَاهَا So we will turn you in the direction of that qibla that you have with. So Allah Ta'ala knows, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam wants Kaaba. So he's looking at the sky waiting for Allah's injunction. But he will not do until Allah says, heart is yearning for Kaaba. But no. And what was one of the wisdoms behind this? Was to win the Jewish community to Islam. They were waiting there for so long. They were waiting for Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That's why many of them did embrace Islam. Many Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Zayd bin Sa'na we learned today. Maymun bin Yameen radiallahu anhu. Abdullah bin Salam radiallahu anhu. Hazrat Safiya radiallahu anha. Hazrat Ta'laba. Hazrat Zayd radiallahu anhu. A community of approximately 30, a list I've seen. But many of the Jewish community in Medina became great Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Allah's Nabi saw Hazrat Abdullah bin Salam in Jannah. He used to go make gush in the Jewish community. He used to tell them, I always taught you about the description of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why don't you accept? Another great Sahabi who used to make gush in the Jewish community. What was his name? Who can tell me? Great Sahabi, very scholarly. Allah's Nabi said, Imam of the ulama on the day of Qiyamah. Imam of the ulama on the day of Qiyamah. Which Sahabi is that? He used to go to the Jewish community. He used to give them da'wat. He used to tell them, you all told us about Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now you all don't want to accept. Hazrat Mu'adh bin Jabal, he used to make gush in the Jewish community. Hazrat Abdullah bin Salam, his aunt, we learned earlier, his aunt is telling him, why are you so happy? If Musa al-Islam had to come, you wouldn't have been as happy. He says, I would. But this is Hazrat Musa al-Islam's brother. I must be just as happy. This is the final Nabi of Allah. And he goes to his aunt, Hazrat Khalda bint al-Harith, oh my aunt, this is Allah's Nabi. Alhamdulillah, she became Muslim. Sahabiyya, radiyallahu anha. Look at Hazrat Safiya, I was pondering today, Hazrat Safiya radiyallahu anha's purity. She says, I heard my father say that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is true, telling my uncle, Safi. Huyay is telling Abu Yasin. I heard my father say to Abu Yasin, his brother, that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is true. So he's asking, what are we going to do now? He says, adawatuhu wallahi ma baqit. I will be his enemy as long as I got breath coming out of me. My every last breath will be hostile towards him. This was the hatred. In many, not in all. We don't make a blanket statement. Allah is the giver of hidayat. Look at Hazrat Safiya. What purity. What purity, Ya Allah. Allah's Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is leaving this world. She is saying, O Nabi of Allah, whatever pain you went through, I can't bear it. I wish all the pain in you is in me. Allah's Nabi opened his eyes and said, I believe you. I know you are sincere in what you are saying. Despite her father's hostility, hatred, that he's dying, and he said, I still hate Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah gave Hazrat Safiya hidayat. Allah made her our mother. How pure she was, Ya Allah, how pure. In Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu's time, there was one slave of hers, wanted to make trouble for her. So the slave went to Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu. Ummul Mu'mineen Safiya, she got contact with the Jews. Another thing she said, you know, Ummul Mu'mineen Safiya, she loves the Saturday. Saturday comes, she do more. She does different things Saturday, Sabbath. Hazrat Umar was a man of wisdom and justice. Allah, his hallmark was justice. He goes to Ummul Mu'mineen. Oh, Ummul Mu'mineen, is this true? Sabbath, you respect Sabbath more. She says, how can that be true? Allah gave us Jumu'ah, what I'll do on Sabbath. Is it true you have interactions and contact and have a lot of relationship with the Jews? She said, of course. They are my family. I join ties with them and I invite them. This is the beauty of Islam. Allah's Nabi taught her, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at her purity. What she did then, she called that slave girl of hers. She asked her, why you did this? No, I just wanted to cause trouble for you. What made you do it? What's your motive of it? No, just shaitan. Look at her chastity, purity, integrity. Look at her character to please Allah. She says, okay, you want to cause trouble for me, no problem. I want to please Allah. I free you in Allah's name. Akhlaq of the pure wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And every one of the Ummahatul Mu'mineen are the purest of the pure because Allah chose them. Wa azwajuhu ummahatuhum, our mothers. And every aspect of their life, mother is one we learn from. They are our mothers according to the teachings of the Quran. So many of the Jews embraced Islam. But Allah Ta'ala made that first period to face Baytul Muqaddas. It was to soften their hearts, to show them that this is the final Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is finality. There's no Nabi after him. There's no change after this. Allah gave them an opportunity to change also because they were very special in their day. Allah says in the Quran, we read it, Ya Bani Israel, Allah addresses them, O Bani Israel, اذكروا نعمتي التي أنعمت عليكم وأني فضلتكم على العالمين. Remember, I have given you such superiority over the world of your time. In their time, they were the best. until Allah brings the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's ummah. Allah says, "Kuntum khayra umma." Y'all are the best. See, they couldn't pass the test of tribalism and racism. They couldn't pass that test. A lot of them, not all of them. Anyway, now Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam during the Medinan period. That was first the Meccan period. Now Medina time. In Medina also he made fikr for Palestine. He sent the Sahabi Hazrat Dihya. Hazrat Dihya goes to the center, Palestine. And at that time, the Roman emperor, he was in Palestine. Because he had just recaptured many of his lands from the Persians. And he came to appreciate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Palestine. So Hazrat Dihya meets him in Palestine. And he sees Rasulullah's letter. He was shocked. He was affected by the letter of Rasulullah. He sends Hazrat Dihya, go speak to the Pope. Hazrat Dihya goes to speak to the Pope. The Pope was inspired. The Pope embraced Islam. The main bishop of the church, he embraced Islam. The first Sunday, the second Sunday. The third Sunday, he didn't come out. Then they threatened him. He came out on the third Sunday, Sheikh Abdisa. He comes out. He gave dawat. He came out in Sunnah Libas. He gave them dawat. They killed him. How fortunate to die in Allah's way. Now when Hazrat Dihya, handsome Sahabi, he looked like the Romans. Now the Romans never treated the Arabs well. So the Arabs called them Banu al-Asfar, the yellow people. Arabs didn't like the yellow color, so they called them the yellow people. But because they ill-treated them, and the Arabs used to come for trade in Roman lands of Damascus and Sham and Jarash and all these regions, they used to ill-treat them and treat them like foreigners. That's why one Sahabi, Hazrat Adi bin Hatim, he was the famous son of Hatim Ta'i. When Allah's Nabi sent Sahaba to his region, he got very scared. He said, "I don't want these Muslims to come here." He told his servant, "When the Muslims come here, tell me I am out." He told someone to guard. As Sahaba were coming, the guard comes to tell him, "What are you planning to do, master? When you hear Muhammad Sallallahu's men coming, rather do it now." He says, "Why? You saw them?" "Yeah, I saw them coming." Oh, he gathered his whole family. Sadly, he forgot his sister. So I always request people, never forget your sister. Your sister came from the same mother's stomach and came from the same father. She feels bad that my brother forgot about me. Sometimes we carry on in life and we forget about our sister. Phone her every now and again. Take care of her. See to her. She's your sister. It's part of deen. Do for her. Send ikram for her. Even though she's married, still we must care for her. And that will give her honor in her own home that she is in. Anyway, he forgot his sister and she felt very, very bad. Safana radiallahu anha was her name. She wasn't a Muslim at that time. She was taken to Medina Munawwara. And among the captives, how a person in Medina Munawwara was given the best treatment. And she saw Islam right in front of her. This is a lengthy incident. But what Ali did, he thought, "I'm not going to the Muslims. Let me go to my..." He was Arab, but he was a Christian Arab. "Let me go to the Romans. Because we follow the same religion, they'll treat us well." Oh, he saw true colors of the Romans. That you can be following the same religion, but you are another nation, you are dirt. Allah save us Muslims from doing the same thing. We are brothers. We never ill-treat people. Our deen's injunction, we love our Muslim brother, irrespective of color, race, nationality. That someone who you bring to Islam or to Islam makes him molal muwala. He's part of your family. That's the beautiful teaching of Islam. Imam Bukhari, what is his name? Imam Bukhari. Muhammad ibn Ismail ibn Ibrahim, and at the top of his name it comes Bardizba al-Ju'fi. Bardizba was his great-great-grandfather, and al-Ju'fi comes in his name. Al-Ju'fi is a family name, like a surname, that was from the man who invited his great-grandfather to Islam, Yaman ibn Akhnas al-Ju'fi. That's the beauty of Islam, that we family each other, we love each other. The greatest scholars were those who were captives, and Sahaba treated them well, liberated them, taught them deen. They became the greatest scholars of Islam. They took Islam to the four corners of the world. This is the beautiful teaching of Islam. Adi bin Hatim saw the true colors of how the Romans treated anybody who's not of their nationality. Allah save us from that disease. Back to this discussion. So Allah's Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Hazrat Dihya." And now, this Roman king who was in Palestine, he asked for Abu Sufyan, to talk to Abu Sufyan, because he asked for an Arab to ask questions about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's another lengthy incident in Bukhari Sharif. But in that, he said, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will actually reach
the lands, and he will take the lands under my feet. I wish I can go to him and wash his feet and show him izzat and respect. This was the statement of the Roman emperor, the king of the most powerful dynasty at that time. Abu Sufyan was shocked. Abu Sufyan. He said, لَقَدْ أَمِرَ أَمْرُ بْنُ أَبِي كَبْشَةً حَتَّى إِنَّهُ لَيَخَافُهُ مَلِكُ بَنِ الْأَصْفَرِ. Ibn Abi Kabsha's deen is so great. That young man in Makkah, we know him not long ago, so great. The Roman emperor is awed by him and has so much of respect for him. This is the beauty of Islam. This is Allah's deen. Allah takes care of his deen. This was in Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's time. Then Allah's Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was leaving this world. He said to Usama. Usama was a young Sahabi, 18 years old. And he prepared Sahaba to go in the path of Allah under Usama. And he said, Anfidhu Jaisha Usama. This army must go in the path of Allah. And some were feeling Allah's Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is not well. Rather they stay behind. Allah's Nabi insisted they must go. Deen carries on. Allah's Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam can be departing from this world, this transitory world, but deen carries on. Usama radiallahu anhu had to be released to go in the path of Allah. Anyway, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi left this world, he returned for the janazah, and as they departed, Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is the Khalifa, and they're going to Roman territory to strive in the path of Allah. Hazrat Usama radiallahu anhu. And as Hazrat Usama radiallahu anhu is leaving, Hazrat Abu Bakr comes, and he requests Hazrat Usama, please Usama, leave Umar behind with me to help me. If do you give that permission? Hazrat Usama says, of course, I give that permission. And how interesting it was. Abu Bakr was the Khalif. He's walking and Hazrat Usama is riding. Some gave the opinion, why don't you call Usama back? Because when Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam just departed from this world, we need whatever resources here. What if Medina is attacked? He said, you expect me to call back men who Allah's Nabi designated to go in the path of Allah? Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was enraged by that opinion. And then he said, I will not give you any more advice, but that which Allah's Nabi said to you, exactly as Allah's Nabi said. And he went into Roman territory. Allah put fear in them. They didn't even pitch before the Muslims. Because before that, they had perpetrated treachery. They had killed some Sahaba, radiallahu anhu. And then he was sent, and he was the Amir, because his father was also killed in the Shami region there. This was in Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's time. Then Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu sent Sahaba into Persia. Then before he left this world, the Sahabi Hazrat Shurahbil bin Hasana saw this vision that Sahaba must be sent to Sham, to Palestine. That's when Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu sent four senior Sahaba. Hazrat Amr bin As radiallahu anhu, Hazrat Ubadah bin Samit, Hazrat Yazid bin Abi Sufyan, and Hazrat Abu Ubaidah bin Jarrah. And not Hazrat Ubadah bin Samit, Hazrat Khalid bin Walid. These Sahaba were designated and they went in the path of Allah to take Islam into Sham and to liberate Palestine. But in that, there was a famous battle called Yarmouk. This is a lot of detail. This was when Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu departed from this world. Then Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu took over. From there, Hazrat Amr bin As, after Yarmouk, he takes Islam into Palestine. But in Palestine, as they sieged, the Palestinians, the Romans, they were not opening. The locals and the Romans were refusing to open. And after a lengthy siege, they said to Hazrat Amr, we want to see your Amir. Then we'll decide. So Hazrat Amr bin As writes to Hazrat Umar, these people don't want to fight, but they want to see you. Some reports say, when they heard the name Amr, they say the name is similar, but the face is not the same. When they saw the face of Khalid, they say the face is similar, but the name is not the same. We have to see the Amir. Hazrat Khalid radiallahu anhu's appearance was similar to that of Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu. And Hazrat Amr radiallahu anhu's name was similar in pronunciation to that of Hazrat Umar. Because Umar is Ayn Mim Ra. Amr got a waw at the end. Amr. Not Amru. It's Amr. That's how you pronounce it. It has a waw at the end. That's how it's written and then pronounced. So Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu leaves Medina Munawwara, the headquarters, the markaz, the center. Everything was happening from there. From Masjid al-Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There was shura. There was sahaba making fikr. There was sahaba making dua. There was sahaba making dhikr. Whatever they were doing everywhere in the world was all decided from here. And whatever was happening there, letters were sent to the headquarters, Medina Munawwara, and the reports were read in Masjid al-Nabawi, where sahaba are taking Islam, who's changing their lives, who's coming onto deen.
What Sahaba are doing every day, report backs were coming into Medina Munawwara. Hazrat Umar was busy in Masjid al-Nabawi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which was the headquarters, which was the markaz. He had to leave that work to carry on there from Masjid al-Nabawi, and he had to undertake this journey. He didn't want to bring many with him because work is carrying on there. He was not a man of pride and glory. He was not a man of arrogance. He just took his servant Aslam. Aslam, both of us will travel together. He didn't want to take anything extra from the Baytul Mal also. One camel, we'll share. And they travel together. How they rode, they don't want to put burden on the camel, we take turns. And they travel right to Sham, right to Palestine. They come to a ford of water, a pond. And it was full of murky, muddy water. And it so happened that it was the turn of Hazrat Umar to get off and Hazrat Aslam to get on. Aslam says, please, Amirul Mu'mineen, you carry on my head. No, it's your turn. Hazrat Umar was justice, complete justice. Irrespective of what people might say or might think or might want, justice is the teaching of Islam. As they're crossing this pond, Hazrat Umar didn't want his moza to get wet. He takes off his khuf, he puts it on his shoulders, and he walks through muddy pond, and the Sahaba are seeing this from a distance, and the Romans are coming and they see this. They're shocked. And as Hazrat Umar arrives at that side, they were shocked to see Hazrat Umar. And they're looking into their scriptures and they're seeing Hazrat Umar. They're looking into their scriptures, they're seeing Hazrat Umar. The simple man with patches, where there was tears on the kurta, he patched it. Patches on his kurta. What was his khutbah? What was his khutbah? In Jabiya, famous khutbah, the main words, he said, "Nahnu qawm, a'azzan Allah bil Islam." Hum aise qawm hai. We are that nation. We are those people who we were nothing. Allah gave us izzat. Allah gave us respect. Allah gave us honor only and only through Islam. فَإِذَا تَغِينَ الْعِزَّةِ. If we look for respect, honor, through any other means but deen and Islam, Allah, Allah will disgrace us. Allah will drop us. This was Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu's words. The Romans were shocked. The local people were shocked. In that, Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu was served with some water. And he enjoyed the water. Look at appreciation. He said, where's this water from? They said, one elderly lady, she presented this water for you. Hazrat Umar says, take me, I want to make her ziyarat. I want to see her. Hazrat Umar goes to see this elderly lady to tell her, shukriya ma, thank you. I appreciate what you did for me. But ma, you must become a Muslim. She was old. Her whole hair was white. She removes her scarf. She says, after this age of mine, I must become Muslim. I must change now. She's trying to convince her, we have to change because we're going to die. Life is short. We have to please Allah. Islam is the truth. She says, no, I'm not prepared to change now. What was Hazrat Umar's reaction? He started to cry. And he read the verses of the Quran. عَامِلَةٌ نَاصِبَةٌ تَصْلَى نَارًا حَامِيَةٌ. And how she has exerted her life in her worship. But she doesn't want to accept the truth. That would lead one to end off in hellfire. And how sad it is when someone exerts themselves and ends up in the fire of Jahannam. You and I learn a lesson here. There's so many people around us. They think what they're doing is right. And you and I know what they're doing is wrong. And we didn't tell them. You know why? We scared. Could be one reason. We scared. Or we don't know how to tell them. Or we just don't give a damn. We don't care. Why? There's rocks here, not hard. There's stone. That we're not worried that somebody is burning outside. If there's a fire there, you and I won't sit here. We'll do something about it. We'll do something about it. Take water. Phone the fire brigade. Make it do something. Even if it's a little puppy or a dog burning, can you and I sleep that night? If we heard that howling and that crying of that dog, this is insan. This is insan. We're living in a non-Muslim country of good people who've never heard in their life that Allah is one and Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the final Nabi of Allah. And we come every day to the masjid and we see them walking past. And we can't stop 5 minutes and say, you know, brother, would you like to join me? Or pick up our neighbor and say, come, I'll give you a chair. See what's it about. Little bit convincing. Maybe he'll say yes. Maybe he'll say no. But we won't do it. You know why? We got no time. We are too busy. Too busy doing what? Eating. Making money. Going home sleeping. Doing what? Hazrat Umar takes out time. He visits this old lady. Can't we take out time to save one person from Jahannam? How many Hindus are committing suicide? Our great-great-grandfathers were Hindu. Someone took out time, showed them love. Come, brother. See how we pray. Our forefathers were non-Muslim. Sahaba's offspring made effort on them. What is in our hearts? Analyze. And if we haven't understood that this is our duty as Muslims, this should make us understand that we are the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after whom there's no Nabi to come. If there was another Nabi to come, you and I can come to the masjid and carry on the way we're carrying on, and it was sufficient. But by Allah, it is not sufficient, because there's no Nabi to come. Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the final Nabi of Allah. There was this amazing karguzari of this man in India, a missionary. He says, I brought so many Hindus and Buddhists to Christianity. I made effort on one Christian family. They finally also accepted. One Jewish family. They said, we don't understand Christianity, but what makes us touch is your compassion and your mercy. A missionary. Sheikh is telling me all the missionaries, they're driven by some passion. But he says, a lot of it is connected to money. But the other thing is very, very strange is, this man says, I always doubted my creed, but what beguiled me was the results that so many people are accepting. In my years of efforts, 17 Muslim families also left Islam because of his efforts. And I've seen this. When we were in Jamaat years ago in India, not far from the Markaz, I saw a missionary working there. So my antennas couldn't bear it. So I called him, come brother, have some tea with me. And he was a missionary, you know, trying to perfect his Urdu, and he was waiting for his visas for Pakistan. We were not long ago, 5 or 6 months ago in Egypt. It was so difficult for us to go into Egypt because they said, no, you're in Jamaat, you can't come in here. So we had to convince them that, no, we're not in Jamaat. Actually, we go with the niyat of Jamaat everywhere, but that trip, we were not in Jamaat. But we wanted to meet Jamaat. So we didn't lie to them. And inside Egypt, you see how many missionaries working there. For us to find a Jamaat was so difficult. Anyway, he says 17 Muslim families left Islam. He says one day in this area, Gaya, that he was in, he made an appointment with a doctor. And he wanted to invite this doctor to Christianity. He didn't go see the doctor for any other reason. Who of us, you and I, will actually make an appointment and pay for the fee of the consultation fee just to save somebody from Jahannam? We won't even think of things like that. You know why? Because we don't care. We don't care about our deen. To sell a car, to sell some cement, to sell some goods, to make some money, to make an extra buck, to buy some property, we're prepared to do anything. And we're going to leave all of it. Allah forgive us. Allah forgive us, we've forgotten that we are the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says this doctor's name was Dr. Sagheer Ahmed. And I realized this man went in Jamaat, he's saying in this interview. He said to me that I can't hear you now. I won't take your consultation fee. Come and see me later, because this is a queue of sickly people who really want to see me. He says, when must I come see you? So I gave him a time. The doctor gave me a time, 7 o'clock. So I came to his house, 7 o'clock, the address he gave me. He waited for me, he fed me with tea and, you know, ikram, snippets and whatever we ate. And then he says to me, what do you want? He says, no, I want to speak to you about Christianity. He says, okay, I'll hear you out. I'll give you a lot of time, I'll hear you. The Muslim is telling him. He says, okay, but only thing I want you to do is, I want you to be sincere. If you recognize the truth, you leave the falsehood and accept the truth. And I will do the same. And both of us make this promise. He says, okay. He says, when will it start? He said, tomorrow. And he said, tomorrow, I'll give you 1 year to explain Christianity to me. Every day, 7 to 8, you come up to 1 year. When you finish, I just want half an hour. I want to explain to you Islam. He said, done. The next day, he says, that night I prayed. I come the next day and I sit in his house, he fed me and I started explaining. But before that he said, what did you pray last night? Did you pray? He says, no, I prayed. He says, be honest, tell me, what was your prayer? He said, I prayed, Lord Jesus Christ, give victory to Christianity. He says, this shows the insincerity of your intentions last night. He says, why? He says, you said that the truth must become apparent to us. And whatever the truth is, we'll accept that. You should have made this prayer.
said, "Oh Almighty God, oh the Lord, guide me and my friend, both of us, to what is true, and help us accept the truth. And not only both of us, the whole of humanity." He says, "I realized what my friend, the doctor, said was correct." So he says, what he said was right, he bowled me over. Anyway, I explained for an hour, I was tired. After that, he asked me a few questions, the second day and the third day. The fourth day, I had nothing else to explain. So after 15 minutes of explanation, I said to him, "I'm sorry, I'm giving you short notice. I was supposed to tell you beforehand, but I really got nothing else to say." And now he didn't take offense. He didn't even prepare. I should have given him time to prepare. But he just started his presentation. And in that half an hour, this priest, missionary, embraced Islam. All it takes is pity on one person. Pity, kindness, care. Give that time. What is he going to say? The most he'll say is, "I'm not interested." No problem. Must I come to your friend and do it? I don't even know your friend. Must you come to my neighbor and do it? You don't even know him. All of us have to do it collectively. Not one or two people. Every one of us. Because we are the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In that, Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu sees a man. He comes to Hazrat Umar. Hazrat Umar remembers him. He says, "You remember me?" Hazrat Umar says, "Of course." And Hazrat Umar goes down memory lane. Hazrat Umar was a youngster. He was a shepherd, caring for his father's camels. His father was very harsh with him. Even if he took a few hours break to come into Makkah, to refresh him, to have something to eat, or do something for his mother's sisters, his aunts, his father Khattab used to reprimand him, "What are you doing here?" He says, I'm just coming to refresh him. I'll be back in a few hours." He said, "What will happen to my camels?" He says, "Okay, you worried about the camels. What about your son?" He says, "I'm not caring. My son will be okay if my camels are okay." As Umar remembers, you know, his father's cruelty with him. And his father was very, very harsh. Anyway, one day he says, "I'm tired of this shepherding. I said to my father, I want to be a businessman." He says, "My father reprimanded me again, saying, where you'll have the money to do business? Please get lost." He says, "One day as I'm taking care and tending to these camels, my brother Zaid comes to me with his savings." He was a businessman. And he casts it to his brother. His brother said, "What's this?" He says, "This is for you. You want to do business? The caravan is going from Makkah to Sham. Go." He was so happy. Hazrat Umar loved his brother. They were very, very close. All his life he remembered his brother. And how he cried when his brother became shaheed. Anyway, Umar is still young at this time. This is past. This is rewinding. Before the advent of Islam, Hazrat Umar is a young man. And now he goes to Sham. And as he's buying and selling and doing some trade, in that one, local calls him, "Hey, you foreigner, come here." And whatever they call foreigners, Allah save us, we should not refer to people with derogatory statements. You and I were the same not long ago. "Inna al-arda lillah," the land belongs to Allah. The land belongs to Allah. Allah borrows it and gives it to whom He wants to give it. We have no right to look down upon any of Allah's creation. Even looking down upon a non-Muslim is haram in our deen. We can be snatched of our iman. Hazrat Manana Qasim Muhammad Sima Rahmatullahi, traveling down the road with some students, there were some drunkards, and in their stupor and in their drunkenness, they were collapsing and swaying. And the students started laughing. Hazrat said, "Why do you laugh? Look at this despicable sight, Hazrat." He said, don't look down upon any of Allah's creation. They might become the greatest awliya, and you and I might be deprived of our iman. In this, he calls Hazrat Umar, "Hey, you foreigner, come here. You see this area here? You clean it up. Remove all this filth and put it in the dump." Hazrat Umar was a man who was very strict. He says, "My brother, my friend, I am a foreigner here. I've come to trade. I'm not prepared to do what you say. Unless you want me to do something and take labor and get paid for it, that's a different story." He pushes Hazrat Umar and says, "You just do as I told you." Hazrat Umar pushed him back. And this man gathered some police to chase Hazrat Umar. And Hazrat Umar runs from there. As he's running, turning this way, into the alleys, into the gullies, one man grabs him, pushes him inside to a monastery, you know, a church. And he closes and he camouflages the whole thing, and they didn't find Hazrat Umar. He presents meals to Hazrat Umar, makes ikram of Hazrat Umar. Hazrat Umar is shocked about what he sees. And then he brings a document. He says, "I want you to sign it." Hazrat Umar says, "Okay, tell me, what is this?" He says, "When you become the ruler of this entire region, be good to me." Hazrat Umar started laughing at this man. "Please, my friend, I'm a foreigner. I'm a nobody. I was a shepherd. And you telling me this, please stop your sarcasm. This is, you know, it's not correct what you mean." He says, "Please, just sign this for me." And Hazrat Umar signed it to please him because he was a host. And he came to Hazrat Umar. And Hazrat Umar arrived in Medina Marawara. And this incident took Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu down memory lane. And Hazrat Umar invited him to Deen and took care of him. And now when he gets into Palestine, Ya Allah, they opened the doors. But this is the man they await. They presented the keys. Hazrat Umar walked with Safanios, a senior bishop and priest. And they walked to the famous church called Kanisatul Qiyama. The famous church, the most holiest site in Christendom. And the discussion took place there. And the document was signed of peace. Peace between the Christians and the Muslims. And the Sahaba who were also there. In this, it was the time of Salah. So he was insisting, you just perform prayer here. Hazrat Umar says, no, I won't do that. He says, why? He says, I don't want you to have trouble. Later someone might say, our Amir performs Salah, we are claiming this land. I don't want any trouble for you. Hazrat Umar insisted, he went far away, and he, some meters away, and he performed the Salah there. And up to today, where Hazrat Umar performed Salah, there's Masjid Umar right there. This church is a very famous church. It's reported historically, and even non-Muslims attest to this, like CNA and so forth, CNN, that up to today, Muslims keep the keys to this church. Imagine this church here, because they were fighting, Muslims open and close the church of the holiest site of Christendom. This is the beauty of Islam. Do this research, you will find this. And in this, Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu goes, and the place where the Christians kept filthy, which was a historical site of the Jews, Hazrat Umar with the Sahaba, they cleansed it. And not far from there, Hazrat Umar established a masjid and they performed Salah there. When the Jews ran the area, they showed disrespect to this church of Isa alayhi salam, where he was raised according to that area. And when the Christians took over, they utilized this area holy to the Jews, Sulaiman alayhi salam's masjid. They used that area as a dump. So each one showed disrespect to the others. But Muslims love all the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam. And that's why we show respect to any site of Hazrat Isa alayhi salam, or Hazrat Sulaiman alayhi salam, or Hazrat Dawood alayhi salam, or Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. Because every one of them is ours. And we love every Nabi of Allah. And we believe in every Nabi of Allah. Alayhi salawatu min Allahi wa taslimat. And from that time, they lived in peace under the Muslims. Muslims ruled. And Christians could come for pilgrimage whenever they wanted to. And this carried on for many, many years. Until centuries later. Centuries. 483 Hijri, which is approximately 1090 in accordance to the Gregorian calendar. There was havoc in Europe. There was trouble. In the entire Christendom, there was poverty. Poverty knew no bounds. There was illiteracy. There was ignorance. There was lack of anything, any sort of civilization. They were still in total darkness. They were in dark ages. That the local people were now unleashing their wrath on the Pope and the papacy and all the and all their kings. And they couldn't bear it. That there was no sort of advancement whatsoever. And they would hear about Muslims and they would go for pilgrimage and they would admire the land of the Muslims. They would refer to it as the lands of milk and honey. And the Pope realized, his name was Urban II, that the only way to get this thing solved is to unleash their wrath somewhere, rather unleash it upon Muslim lands. So they had to create false images of events, creating false rumors, saying Muslims are ill-treating Christian pilgrims, which was not a reality, which was not true. Yeah, sometimes they cut out the ankle of a Christian just to see if there's gold there, or he paid his taxes, or they just slaughtered Christians. Total lies. Lies, they made up these stories. But they had to unleash their wrath somewhere. Because they were totally backward. They didn't even know things like windows. When Muslims had every sort of advancement, medicine, technology, soap, cleanliness, a pure lifestyle, they had nothing of that sort. They didn't even know about the importance of the usage of water. Some historical reports say they would actually bath. Some reports say once a year. A lot of reports say once a month they used to bath. Bathing after relationship was nothing, was not even considered in them. It was a life of filth and backwardness and waywardness. And now they had to unleash this wrath somewhere. And now the Pope started distributing checks of forgiveness. that if you go and take the Muslim lands and fight the Muslims, you will be forgiven. It's called Sukukul Maghfira. You'll be forgiven. And this announcement was made. Peter, the devotee, came forward and he then bowed before the Pope and he took this responsibility and he started now going. And they gathered more than 80,000 people and they now started going towards Muslim lands. And this is a deep and a lengthy portion of our history. But what happened here was very, very sad. That at this time, the Shia were ruling Egypt. They were ruling Egypt for many years before this, approximately 150, 200 years before this. Shia had that strong footing. And the capital of Ahlus Sunnah was Baghdad. And the Shia actually wrote to the Christians saying, you're welcome to come. We don't mind you're coming to take the lands from Ahlus Sunnah. And from here we learn how deadly and dirty were the Shia. That they are more deadly than anything. That's why there was a famous scholar. His name was Abu Bakr al-Nabulsi. He said, if I have 10 arrows, I'll shoot one at the Crusaders and 9 at the Shia. The Shia ruler arrested this alim. His name was Mu'is, this ruler. And he asked the scholar, Abu Bakr al-Nabulsi, did you make the statement that if I have 10 arrows, I'll shoot one at the Shia, 9 at the Crusaders? He said, no. So he thought he's refusing and he's scared. He said, no, I said I'll shoot 9 at the Shia and 1 at the Crusaders. Oh, he was so enraged and infuriated. He got this alim hung. And then he was skinned alive. And he remained like that for 3 days. And then the Jew who was doing his torturing then took pity on the pain and the pangs he was going through and then just ended his life and stabbed him. But this is what they would do. Brutal torture. Shia were always with any force against the Muslims, against the truth. Why? Because their entire objective is to attack Islam. That's why they attack Sahaba. First they will attack Sahaba. It doesn't end there. It's to attack deen. But you have to first gun down Sahaba, radiallahu anhum, na'udhu billah, to say, let's see Sahaba who brought the deen to you. The Sahaba are incorrect. How can the deen be pristine and pure? So they have an agenda. Anyway, as these Christians came, and they took town after town. And this is a lengthy history. Antioch and Tabriya and Nablus. And what they did, desecrated and decimated. No differentiation, man, woman and child. And the saddest part is Shia used to actually congratulate them. And finally, by the time they reached Palestine, in 485, they came in and they sieged. And they came in and decimated and desecrated every person. Every person there, all the Muslims, 80,000 Muslims were there, young, old, big, small, male, female, all ran into the masjid. And they came in and opened fire and slaughtered. That even up to today, Christian writers describe the scene that it was mayhem. It was hands and feet and pillage all separated from the body, all swimming in pools, oceans of blood. It was pillage. It was unprecedented. It was total cruelty. And the Shia are responsible because they called them to come. Shia of Egypt at that time. And the Muslims were now totally removed and these lands then became under the Crusaders. And who was to fight back? There was nobody. And now the ulama made effort. This was the time of Imam Ghazali rahimahullah, Tartushi rahimahullah, Abdul Qadir Jilani rahimahullah. And now the Abbasid rulers had become weak because as the rulers started coming more into opulence and luxury where they want to fight and defend Islam. This is the sad reality when we become too luxurious that we're not prepared to even stand for Allah's deen. Look at you and me. We can't even spend few days out of our home. No, I must have my bed. I must have my comfort. I must have my everything, you know, according to my sequence. We're not prepared to change anything for Allah's deen. So similar thing happened at that time for the rulers. Everything became so hunky-dory and comfortable. That's why we need to live a simple life. We need to go through little difficulties sometimes. We need to live simplicity. But the ulama made effort. To crux the whole story here, there was a great man who stood up, whose name was Imaduddin. Imaduddin Zingi. A man before him, his name was Maudud. Rahimahullah. Maudud tried. But there was a group called the Assassins, Hashashun. And they were a branch of the Shia.
What they used to do, instead of fighting the Christians, they went to kill any Muslim who was standing up to try and get back Muslim lands. And they had a very, very deadly strategy. And it's reported historically that they would take drugs so they don't know what they're doing. Allah save us, save our children, save our offspring from drugs. That's why they call it hashashun. They would take these drugs and that would make them, you know, unconscious to an extent, and then they would do brutality like this. Act like he's begging for something. And obviously this Muslim ruler now who's guarded, but now wants to give this needy person something, and then he would unleash his true face and pounce on this individual and assassinate him like that. Many Muslim rulers were killed by the Shia like this. This is history. It's documented. It will not lie to you. This is the true face of such people who disrespect Sahaba radiallahu anhu. That shaitaniyat is inside there. It's just hidden. It's camouflaged. It's total hypocrisy. In this, that's why you can't trust anything they say. And then we still think, no, but they're the only people saying this and saying that. There's always an ulterior motive. In that, beloved brothers, and the sad reality is what is Muslim saying also? What are Muslims saying? Not even, look at the condition of Muslims. But history tells us this. Allah. In that a man stood up, Imaduddin Zengi. He tried very hard. The Zingit family and the Ayyubid family. That's why there's a beautiful kitab called Rodatain. Two beautiful, luxurious gardens, gardens of Islam, referring to these two families. Rodatain is the name of the book. Written by an eyewitness called Abu Shama, rahimahullah. An amazing book, 5 volumes. And he describes these two families and how Allah used them. And they weren't Arab. What was that to teach us? That irrespective of one's nationality or color or race, he has fervor for Islam. He has love for deen. Allah will use you. Put yourself forward to Allah. And then Imaduddin stood up. How he came into contact with the Ayyubids. In one battle, he was returning and they were at a loss and he was badly wounded. The governor of this fortress in Takrit. Takrit was a fortress conquered by Hazrat Umar in Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu's time, 16 Hijri. So up to that time, it was still in Muslim hands. And the governor was this man whose name was Najmuddin Ayyub. Najmuddin bin Shadi Ayyubi. And he sees these Muslims in trouble. So he sends a boat to give them resort. And he brings them into his fortress. And those who were chasing them, you know, they were safe from him. And the leader of this group who were wounded was Imaduddin. Rahimahullah. So Najmuddin Ayyub tended to his wounds and was hospitable to him for 15 days. This is the beauty of Islam. Love, respect, inviting, showing compassion, mercy. And this built a bond. And then Imaduddin then went back to Mosul because the land he ruled was Mosul. Few years later, there was trouble because Najmuddin was now deposed because the ruler of that region took back that fortress that Najmuddin was running. So this little town that Najmuddin is ruling, Takrit, was now taken from him by force by one person whose name was Nahruz. And the reason he did that was Najmuddin's brother whose name was Shirgu. Shirgu in Arabic, Shirgu in the other languages, in their language. Asaduddin Shirgu, he was a very just man. And there was one guard who was connected to the governor of that region who oppressed a woman. So this man was very upset, he killed that man. And now the message got to that actual ruler of the entire area and he now unleashed his wrath on Najmuddin and his family and said, if you're not out of here by dawn, we're going to destroy you. So Najmuddin that night had to depart. He didn't know where to go. And that same night, his little infant was born. He's about to leave and his wife falls into labor. Oh, Najmuddin was very upset. He had to halt all his plans. He wants to go. He can't be here by dawn. The armies of the governor are coming in. There'll be pillage. He has to go. And he's waiting and the labor had some delay. And there was trouble. Anyway, the child was born afterwards. Najmuddin was very upset. He thought, hey, this is no good. His brother Asaduddin told him, no, Allah will bless this child. He thought this child is not going to live. We won't even make it towards the end of this journey because we don't even know where we're going. Anyway, he went to Imaduddin. He remembered Imaduddin, that this is my brother. I was there for him. Maybe he'll be there for me. He traveled to Imaduddin. Imaduddin welcomed him, took care of him, made him one of his right-hand men. Najmuddin and his brother Asaduddin Shirgo. And alhamdulillah, the little boy grew up. His name was Yusuf. His father didn't feel he was so good, but his uncle loved him. His uncle loved Yusuf. Anyway, he grew up in this environment of Imaduddin. And Imaduddin's son was Nuruddin. Imaduddin was a mujahid. A man whose life was Allah's deen. He slept in a tent. His work was to protect Muslim lands from the crusaders. And what they took, take it back. And Allah blessed him. From the many provinces they took, one area, Edessa, he took it back. And what glad tidings he received in dreams, that Allah Ta'ala blessed him and Allah is happy with his efforts. Anyway, he was towards another area, Ruha, a province that the crusaders had taken. And the sad reality is, there, whilst he was sieging this area, Ruha, again, a servant who acted to presented to work for him and serve him. And reality proved that he was also an assassin, a Shia, who came into service and pretended to serve Imaduddin, stabbed Imaduddin whilst he was in his sleep. This is the harm that they caused in our history. Study it, it's there for you to see. Anyway, Allah is the doer. Imaduddin passed away, Shaheed Imaduddin, and then his son, Nuruddin, was instated to take the position of his father. And Ya Allah, what a man is Nuruddin. He was a scholar. He was a lover of ulama. He was a lover of deen. He was upon the Hanafi fiqh madhab. He was Hanafi madhab. He wrote books on deen. He wrote kitab al-jihad. He knew fiqh. He loved hadith. He was a scholar of hadith. He would listen to hadith with respect. He would love to practice hadith. Every hadith he learned, he would make amal on it. He was the first man to establish Darul Hadith. In his time, the drums were beaten at the time of tahajjud that every Muslim must wake up for tahajjud. We want Allah to give us Palestine. This was his mizan. We can't even wake up for tahajjud. This was Nuruddin. He was humble. When ulama came to him, he stood up to welcome them. He stood with them. He made them sit in his seat. The fuqaha, the ulama, the pious, the old, the elderly. He had many properties. He used to spend of his own in the path of Allah. He never ate from the Baytul Mal. Many a time, everything he had, he gave in the path of Allah. Sometimes his wife needed something, he didn't even have to give her because he already gave it in the path of Allah. How much of his properties he gave as waqf? Rahimahullah. Nuruddin. Mahmud Nuruddin. In the battlefield, he was in the front line. But they would tell him, what will happen to Islam if you die? He would say, La ilaha illallah. How dare you show disrespect to Allah like that? Who is Mahmud? I am nothing. Allah is the preserver of Islam. Allah will take care of Islam. Ibn al-Athir rahimahullah says, I studied the life of people. I have not seen a man like Nuruddin. Salahuddin was his student. That youngster who we spoke about, Yusuf, born that night, he made it there. And Imaduddin welcomed him. That youngster Yusuf was Salahuddin. Salahuddin's mother used to send him, see the Mujahideen training, see them riding the horses, see them striving in the path of Allah every day. And every day the discussion was fikr for Palestine, fikr for Palestine. Every day, fikr for Palestine, worry for Palestine. And as Yusuf grew, he was in charge of the police department under Nuruddin. And in that, the Shia ruling Egypt were facing trouble because there was internal trouble. There were two ministers fighting for rule under the Shia dynasty. The Shia dynasty were claiming Khilafah. And obviously Ahlul Sunnah didn't accept them. But now there was a fight between two ministers, and then they asked help from Nuruddin. So Nuruddin saw the opportunity and he sent Asaduddin Shirgu, and Asaduddin, he asked Nuruddin, the ruler, the governor, the ruler, he said, send my nephew with me. So he said, okay, take Salahuddin with you. So Salahuddin and Asaduddin went into Egypt and they helped Shawar. Shawar was a very treacherous man. They helped him because he asked for help. Nuruddin sent him. Now when they helped, Shawar promised a certain area to Nuruddin's people, but then he didn't pay what he was supposed to pay. Anyway, when they came back, Shawar showed his treachery. And then Nuruddin threatened him, why didn't you pay us? We'll show you. He said, you show me, the crusaders are my friends. So now he started writing to the crusaders, help me against Nuruddin. This is how dirty was this minister, Sahabaar. And then Nuruddin sent Asaduddin Shirgu and Salahuddin Yusuf again. Why? Because the Shia ruler himself, his name was Adid, he realized Sahabaar is a very, very treacherous man. He wrote to Nuruddin, please, you help me. And he was very sick. Nuruddin sent Asaduddin and Salahuddin into Egypt. When they came into Egypt, in that Sahabaar tried to poison, and they conquered the crusaders. They conquered the crusaders in battle because the crusaders wanted Egypt. Salahuddin and Asaduddin conquered the crusaders, defeated the crusaders, and the Shia ruler, he loved the character of the Muslims, of the Sunnah. And Sahabaar, who tried to kill the uncle of Salahuddin and poison him, alhamdulillah, he got killed. And Asaduddin was then reinstated as the minister of Egypt. But this was a shock, because the Shia is the ruler and Nuruddin's man is the minister of Egypt. And not long after that, Asaduddin Shirgu passed away. But Adid, who was the Shia ruler, he loved Salahuddin. He loved his akhlaq. He loved his character. He loved his loyalty. He loved his purity. He chose Salahuddin to be his minister. And Salahuddin had to take the post, because it's one step closer to remove falsehood. Sometimes Allah Ta'ala uses people of evil nature. But Adid was from an evil dynasty. But we find from the descriptions of Salahuddin, he had goodness in him. So sometimes you find that. You find that. You find somebody who really wants to change, who really wants to be a good person. Those who do Jamaat will find this. You see, most of Ajib people, Allah Ta'ala wants to put goodness in them. There is some hope. The Jews, so many Jews embraced Islam. We were in Jamaat in Palestine years ago. There was one Jewish youngster who was in the Markaz. It was shocking. He was in the Markaz. So he wanted to join us, you know, for our chillah there. So Amir Sahib said, no, you can't take him because he could be a spy, he could be this, he could be that. 30 days later, we were sent to a masjid near Masjid Al-Aqsa. So in this masjid we were staying, Amir Sahib sent that Jewish youngster to join us for 5 days, because obviously he checked him out, he assessed the situation after 1 month. Now this is a sincere young man. And look at that, this youngster became Muslim. What about that beautiful incident you must have read about Sheikh Ibrahim, the Turkish man Ibrahim, and he was in a building in France and he was selling this whatever goods, and a Jewish family who owned a store in the same building would always send their son every morning to bring some goods and buy goods from the store. So this little boy at the age of seven would come and take the goods and return to his family, but every day he used to steal a packet of chocolates. Every day he would do this. One day after a few months, Uncle Ibrahim saw that the youngster forgot his chocolate. So he says, son, you forgot your chocolates? He realized, oh, uncle, you saw me taking every day. He says, don't worry, you can take. He says, no, uncle, I promise you I'll never steal again. He says, my son, that's a very good intention. If you make that, that's a very good intention. Don't steal from anybody. He says, I won't steal from anybody. But then uncle tells him, Uncle Ibrahim, what you do? Every day when you come to take your parents' goods, you take your packet of chocolates every day. And he became so close to this Muslim, Sheikh Ibrahim. This was a Jewish boy. And every time he faced difficulty, he used to come to Uncle Ibrahim. Uncle Ibrahim used to open one wooden box. Say, my son, open this book. The verse your eye falls on, that will be your solution. So, his eye falls on a certain verse. Uncle used to explain to him, this is the meaning of this verse. And they used to talk for hours and hours. And years later, when Uncle Ibrahim passed away, he left in his wasiyah that this box with the special magical book must go to that youngster, my son, that youngster. And this youngster was depressed when Uncle Ibrahim passed away, because now he doesn't know where to go. Uncle used to solve his problems. Uncle used to sit with him. Uncle used to talk to him. Uncle used to, you know, console him, show him love. This is what Ummah needs. Just the other day, a week ago, a policeman in Newcastle, a friend of mine tells me that this youngster, this elderly policeman, is depressed. And he said to a few people he wants to commit suicide. So we said, let's go visit this brother. He's Allah's creation. He's Allah's banda. Let's show him some love. So we went to visit him. Took for him some coffee, some donuts, some ikram. He got so happy. He sat with us. We explained to him about the love of Allah, about the shortness of Islam. He's depressed. And he took something that's called depression leave. First time in my life I heard of something like this. But there's so many people like this in the world. A few years ago, his daughter committed suicide. Now, 6 months ago, he lost his brother and his wife. He couldn't bear it. We explained to him about Allah. He says, I find it very hard to believe because how this happened to me? And I've never lied in my life. I don't take bribes. And he explained to him about the Quran. So we open the Quran and tell him that, you know, the verse your eye falls on is your solution. And Allah made us open to the verse of Yusuf alayhi salam, Surah Yusuf, إِنَّمَا أَشْكُوا بَثِّي وَحُزْنِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. And we explained to him Surah Yusuf. He says, when you go, just read the Quran, yeah, I want to read. So anyway, this youngster is depressed and he remembers the box. So he goes to open the box and he sees a note there that if you have any trouble, go to this uncle from Tunisia. He also got a store there and choose your verses and he'll talk to you. That was a message for this little boy. Now he's obviously at 25, 26 years old. And he goes and he speaks to this other brother from Tunisia and he chooses the verse and he sees the beauty in this book. And he asks his son, what is this magical book that has the solution to everything? He says, this is the Quran. He says, then in that case, I want to believe in the Quran. I've been believing in this book all my life. And he embraces Islam. All it takes is love and compassion to humanity. Anyway, Nuruddin this was, who made deen available and showed love to humanity and kindness and mercy. Salahuddin then becomes the minister of Egypt. When he becomes the minister of Egypt, some people try to put trouble for him by Nuruddin. You see, Salahuddin, he wants to overthrow you. This is shaitaniyat. You know, some people become jealous when somebody is doing something good, when somebody is progressing. So they're telling Nuruddin, see, he becomes a minister of Adid, and he's your man. Nuruddin was so wise. He says to those foolish people around him who say these things, he said, how foolish are you? You expect Salahuddin to ask me before taking that position when he knows our goal is Palestine. I can't expect him now to come right to me and ask me when he's in a catch-22 and he's being watched. I have to understand the situation. I know his loyalty. Look at the beautiful response of Nuruddin and understanding and wisdom and high-mindedness of Nuruddin. This is how they made effort slowly, slowly. And that's how he eradicated Shiism from Egypt. Alhamdulillah. And from there, years later, when Nuruddin passed away, that was Salahuddin rahimahullah. Trying hard. Nuruddin actually prepared the mimbar for Masjid al-Aqsa. But he passed away. 569 he passed away. Look, Salahuddin had to carry on with his efforts. But first he had to unite the Muslim world. Muslims had to come on to deen. And he tried hard. Years and years of effort. He himself used to wake up everybody for tahajjud. We want Aqsa and we can't wake up for tahajjud, he's telling them. He used to wake them up. He loved Quran. He used to choose the Imam himself. He used to cry and listen to the Quran. And then he made his way. Incident is lengthy. We'll discuss this when we get a chance another time. Salahuddin's life. What a man was Salahuddin. How he brought the change. And how finally, in the year 5583, Alhamdulillah, 583 was Hittin. 585, it was Rajab, when he entered Baytul Muqaddas victoriously. But look at his treatment. 89 years ago, how they treated the Muslims. 89 years later, the Christians were given amnesty. They were given security. They wanted to fight, the Muslims fought. They gave in, Muslims left them. Muslims entered, they were allowed to leave peacefully. You can stay, you can leave. You live under us, you pay the jizya. So many people who couldn't pay the tax to leave, which was 10 dinar, they couldn't pay. And the main archbishop was leaving with boxes of gold from the church. So Salahuddin Sa'atis are telling him, why are you allowing that bishop to take all that money? Shouldn't he pay for the slaves and for the downtrodden and for the poor and the needy Christians? The bishop doesn't want to pay for his own Christians. And he takes all the gold and he leaves and he just pays his 10 dinars and he goes. Salahuddin says, leave them. Let them see what they are. And he himself from his own pocket paid for so many poor Christians who couldn't manage. His brother did the same. Other Muslims who could manage from their own paid to the Baytul Mal for Christians to be liberated. No church was harmed. No Christian was harmed. No woman was harmed. No child was harmed. And even the man who went in, who asked Salahuddin's permission, allow me entry. Just to take my wife
His wife was the princess of Palestine because that was the Christian rule for those years. Allow me to take my wife and my children and I'll be out in a few hours. He goes in, he takes his wife and his children, and then the local people are telling him, you have to fight for us. You can't go. He says, no, I promise Salahuddin I'll be out. They said, you can't go. He says, then I have to ask Salahuddin's permission. He goes out to Salahuddin, sieging them. He says, please, give me permission to do my religious right, that I have to fight for Palestine. He says, why do you want to fight? Give in, it'll be peaceful. He couldn't believe that a Muslim, that Muslims could react like this after what they did not long ago, which was fresh in their memories. He says, no, I have to fight. Salahuddin says, fine, I allow you to go in. He says to Salahuddin, you know, I wish I could find something in you that could make me hate you, but there's nothing. You people are different. And he allowed him to go in and to lead his people in that war. And they tried and they tried. And alhamdulillah, Muslims still won. And when Muslims entered, they gave them peace. He went in, they cleaned the masjid. Read the history. But then what happened after that was very, very sad, because then the whole of Europe was shocked and awakened. Palestine was taken by the Muslims. And now Richard the Lionheart and the King of Germany and the King of France all are marching with their hundreds of thousands to take back Palestine. And Salahuddin is defending Palestine. And this time it was very, very sad because he asked Muslims all around the world to come and help him. But he had very few helpers. But the ajeeb part is, quite a few of those army generals as they were coming, they died. That's quite interesting in history. And Richard, who made it, as he was coming, he got sick. Prior to him getting sick, he killed so many Muslim captives in area, Muslim prisoners who were locked up in the prisons and the dungeons. He killed over 4,000 of them in front of Muslims. But the ajeeb part is, when he got sick, Salahuddin sent medication and food and fruit for him. This is akhlaq that the world can't understand. This is Muslims. As the poet says so beautifully, مَلَكْنَا فَكَانَ الْعَدْلُ مِنَّا سَجِيَّةً فَلَمَّا مَلَكْتُمْ سَالَ بِالدَّمِ أَبْطَحُ وَحَلَّلْتُمُ قَتْلَ الْأُسَارَى وَطَالَمَا غَدَوْنَا عَلَى الْأَسْرَى نَمُنُّ وَنَسْفَحُ فَحَسْبُكُمُ هَذَا التَّفَاوُتُ بَيْنَنَا وَكُلُّ إِلَاءٍ بِالَّذِي فِيهِ يَنْضَحُ. He says, when you ruled, you flowed, we had bloodbaths. But when we ruled, there was justice, integrity, love, compassion, mercy. We forgave, we showed compassion. He says, what we can say is a utensil will only pour out what is inside it. And a Muslim has Allah in his heart. Allah, who is Rahman, mercy will emanate from his hands. And others have cruelty and hatred in their hearts. And that's what came out from them. So Allah give us perfect. This is the beauty of our deen. When Salahuddin liberated Palestine, you know what he said? He said, you think my job is done? No. I want Allah to bring wonderful governors who rule all these areas with justice. And I want to go town to town, country to country, inviting one person to Allah. He says, my job is not done. This is what I have to do. The history is lengthy. Beloved brothers, we have to study our history. It's not just one lesson and finish. We have to realize that history repeats itself. We have to come back to deen. We have to bring alive deen in us and in humanity. Let's make a change. Let's make a change. We can. Instead of us talking about why this ruler is saying this, and why he's not saying anything, and why he's not doing nothing, and why he doesn't want to do anything, and why he doesn't want to help in any way, what have you and I done? Allah is not going to ask us what people are doing, or what they are not doing. Allah is going to ask us what difference we made in the control Allah gave us, that we bring that into being. And who we can reach, can we connect them to Allah? All the people we have association with, did we invite them to be? Did we make deen available to them? Allah will ask us what difference, what change we made. Let us do that. Let's make a difference. Fikr taking place in the masjid, make some fikr. Somebody interested to come and see the masjid, bring him. Teach him wudu, show him. Make an environment, create an environment. Make a difference. Anybody interested in Islam, Maulana Sahib is such a wonderful natured person. Bring him. Maulana will answer his questions. Explain to him lovingly. What is Islam? Will we do this, inshallah? The last 2 or 3 minutes, you tell me what you think we must do. What else we can do? Can we do that, inshallah? Every day make tahajjud. Make sure our 5 times daily salah is with jamaat, with takbir ula. Salah al-Din, Nur al-Din. Salah was with jamaat in the masjid, takbir ula. They never miss their sunnah. They never miss their manawafin. There's 12 sunnah mu'akkada every day. Sahaba never missed. We all will do that, inshallah. Who's going to share Islam with others? Make intention, inshallah. Any person we know, any person we associated with, our neighbors, our friends, our colleagues, our patients, that's a start. That will come with us when we leave this world. And also very, very importantly, we love each other for Allah's sake. If somebody's elderly, treat him like our father, irrespective of his nationality, nation, color, race. If he's my age, my brother. If he's younger than me, he's my son and my child. Will we do this, inshallah? And if there's any tiff between us and somebody, we must be the first to ask for maaf. That will give us the love of Allah. That is more valuable than years and years and years of tahajjud. Because that makes Allah happy and makes shaitan sit in the corner crying. Irrespective of whether it's with our women folk or our children or our family or our relatives or our neighbors or our people. If there's any tiff, be the first to ask for maaf. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahu ala nabi ummi wa rahmatika ya Rabbil Alameen. Ya Rabbi salli wa sallim da'iman abadan ala habibika khayrit khalqik. Oh Allah, accept our brothers, Allah. Allah, bless this community, Allah. Allah, brothers, sat for your sake to learn the history of Islam. Allah, accept deen in them and all of us, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Preserve deen in our progenies, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Bring alive the likes of Salah al-Din, Nur al-Din, Imad al-Din. In our children, in our progenies, in us, those who will love your deen, strive for your deen, sacrifice for your deen, those who will value your deen, Ya Allah, save us from turning our backs onto your deen. Save us from not making a difference. Enable us to be the difference and make a difference and bring a change. And enable us to be better people. Enable us to show character and akhlaq, the beautiful qualities of our Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Enable us to love each other for your sake. Ya Allah, enable us to understand this duty of ours, this duty of inviting people to your greatness. This is our duty, but we still haven't understood it, Ya Allah. Give us that concern and care. Give us heart, Allah. Make us insan, Allah. Allah, remove the stones from inside our hearts. Give us hearts, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Oh Allah, we ask you for all good, for the entire ummah of our Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the four corners of the world, especially in Palestine, in China, in Syria, in France, and everywhere wherever our Muslims are suffering. You make it easy for them. Alleviate this pandemic, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Give shifa to one and all. Allah, what people are saying and the media is saying is so confusing. We don't understand. You keep us cured and well and enable us to serve your deen till our last breaths, Ya Rabbal Alameen. And that when we leave this world, accept us to leave in your path. Allah, we ask you for all good for the entire ummah of our Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in the four corners of the world. Ya Rabbi bil Mustafa, balligh maqasidana, waghfir lana ma mada, ya wasi'al karami, wa sallallahu ala nabi al-ummi, bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. جزاكم الله خير.